2 metres of the edge, the bearing weight of a house front wall. The report of planning committee says that it appears to officers that the works have been carried out to reduce the risk of instability of this land. It also draws attention to paragraph 178 and 179 of the NPPF. Whilst in this case, that paragraph 179 states, where a site is affected by contamination or land stability issues, responsibility for securing the safe development rests with the developer and or landowner. Paragraph 178 states, planning policies and decisions should ensure that a site is suitable for its proposed use, taking account of ground conditions and any risk arising from land instability and contamination. This includes risks arising from natural hazards or former activities such as mining and any proposals for mitigation, including land remediation, as well as potential impacts on the natural environment arising from the remediation. Having visited the site and examined the photo I have circulated, I would expect that members will only approve this application if they are satisfied that the site is indeed site is suitable for its proposed use, taking account of ground conditions and any risks arising from land instability. Otherwise, I recommend you review the application or defer it until this important question is resolved. I'm going to add to this because quite often we're now starting to see, coming through the planning departments, a lot of retrospective planning applications. And whilst that is largely down to people building things that they shouldn't build before they've got planning permission, this particular one is because they haven't really provided the information that is required by planning regulations beforehand, and we've had officers giving agreement to and approving planning applications before having all that material in front of them. We are now, as a planning department and the council, starting to stray into areas where we're giving planning permission and overriding our own rules and regulations, and it is now becoming apparent this has happened on a couple of occasions in HESWALL, and I do not want to see that our planning department is now straying into these areas. So whilst that is a statement I am making personally, I do have concerns that this has been built on and has not been able to be inspected during the building of it, because it's now a retrospective and it could lead us to problems in the future. If this slips, the front of the house goes, and we as a planning department have guaranteed that this land has been okay for this building on. Generally, we haven't done our job well. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to ask any questions of Councillor before we get into? Just a point on the business of retrospective planning applications. I mean, there's two possible ways of looking at that, because that we're receiving retrospective plan applications as a result of enforcement activity. So good enforcement activity is bound to produce planning applications to which by their nature will be retrospective because of the product of an enforcement investigation. In this particular case, my understanding is that the new dwelling and its extension were subject to proper and timely planning applications, so there's no question the developer has attempted to do everything with the bulk of the development behind our back, and it's potential that that there's been confusion about the requirement for planning permission for retaining wall is the reason that this one is retrospective as opposed to any I suppose the development wishing to, if you like, go ahead with something that they're not taking to clearly the developer, would be more than happy to apply for permission for substantive development. In terms of have we considered land stability issues, page 50 of our reports, I guess 3.7 onward, will deal with the issue of stability for having put together. My take also is that some of the complaints or some of the issues that you raised fall more properly towards building control. Indeed, you mentioned building control when you are building regulations as far as you are. That aspect clearly isn't a matter for this committee. It's a matter for building control, which will enjoy, and they will enjoy, significant delegated powers. They don't consider the thing to be a stable theoretic direction as a people. Okay, moving back to members.
Just wanted to go on a couple of points on item 332, the safety and delete policy GR5 requires applicants to submit a full landscape proposal before all permits are granted, which include areas of new ground modelling and the appropriate in terms of the nature and location of the development proposal, the visual requirements of the site, the potential visual impact of the development and the character of the surrounding area and then other areas. Would the application for the extension of the actual house, would that have been granted if the application for these groundworks been submitted at the same time? So what I'm trying to find out is whether or not if the applicant had put in an application at the same time as the planning application for the groundworks, would the application in its entirety have been granted planning permission the same way? Having been on the site visit, I didn't understand from the application having been approved and gone through that the garden next door looks like it's sleeping slightly, as well as Councillor Rowlands alluded to, that the gardens have been slightly slipping probably over the last 42 years. So, if you accept that grounds are slipping and therefore these havens would have to be put in at some point and possibly on other properties in the future, point is, would the application totally have been approved if this retrospective application had been from the beginning, or is it irrelevant as it's coming now? So would it have had a material effect on the original approval of the application?
Okay, so through you, Chair, just to be clear, this application relates only to the retaining wall structure. It has nothing to do with the house. The house has got permission. It was approved. The plans that are up on the screen in front of you, they were approved when the house was first submitted. So there's been no exception to the house. This part here was always part of the original approval. The 2008 application, 2018 application, that Councillor Rowlands referred to, was an application for the discharge of conditions. So additional information was submitted in relation to the conditions that were attached to the 2017 permission. Those conditions were discharged based on the information that was provided. Subsequent to that, enforcement have been out and they've measured all the land levels across the site. And where the house has been built, there has been no raising in the land levels. So we're only talking about retaining structure. I think, as Andrew has pointed out in his report, views of the gabions from the dales below, you only get fleeting glimpses because of the amount of vegetation that exists already. And given the stability issues on the site already, I'm not sure it's advisable to be adding to that burden by putting additional landscaping and planting on the site. But we don't think it's necessarily certain from the screening point of view.
We also, for those that went on the site, concrete wall. We have put it, looking at it from the edge, it would look like a stone wall because it's been finished in. It's not rubbing with the mesh. So it does have a semi normal feel to it, even as it stands. So it isn't. It is concrete as it backs up the garden, but it's facing. It's as if it was a wall of stone. So.
As someone on the side business, certainly created in that, and I have a lot of thought that the structure is centered, as you can see, it's built in, it's built in that land, overlooking the Hesswall Downs. That's no reason to name the property, and those clear evidence, so there's still there, the edges are subsiding.
Significant amount considering it's in the direct locality of the actual development from, for anyone who knows it, from Arden Street up, literally halfway up the road, of Alden Road. The issue is that they believe that there will be a considerable increase in vehicles parked on the roads in what is already a tow street with, on the corner, a supermarket, which is open until late, which does cause traffic congestion within that particular area. There was another application that went in from the developer, and it was commendable that they actually pulled it in the end and took the application away, which was for extra dwellings, and I commend them for doing that. This is still three more bedrooms, and my residents' concerns are that when they raised it with me, and subsequently every house that I knocked out without actually prompting them in any way, shape or form said pretty much exactly the same thing, which with the increase of bedrooms, potentially increasing people, it could well follow and be unfair that there'll be an increase in cars. Now, owing to there being no parking provision whatsoever within this development, which seems to be a strange new phenomenon that I don't understand that officers and in fact this planning committee seem to take as acceptable in the interest of what's sustainability and in the interest of sustainability and the promotion of public transport. Now, while planners may believe that there will only be nominal increase in traffic congestion from such developments, this is highly subjective, and clearly my residents believe otherwise. An example of why I would say that anyway is the fact that well, we all received an email this week. If any of the individuals to move into this area or this particular department were out of our hospital, for example, they will surely not be able to get there directly. And we can pretend that they may cycle, or we can pretend that they will be happy to get two buses. But these will probably be facilities people, cleaners, ancillary staff, doctors and nurses even potentially, who are not going to wait for two buses in order to get from Hoylake to our park. The reality is they are going to have a car, and it doesn't matter how many times we try to convince ourselves that that isn't the case. It is at the minute. While Hoylake is fantastically linked to West Cairn, to Liverpool, to Birkenhead, the rest of the Whittle, it is not. And people will still have cars while that is the case. Now, having said all of that, the developer has made a very reasonable offer as well, as a compromise, which is to fund, or certainly look into the funding, because there would need to be a feasibility study of the parking payment scheme within the in the vicinity of the development. Now, I've had some correspondence from Matthew and also from Carlos, who believes it might need to be a bigger scheme than what I'm actually suggesting. I don't believe it would. The congestion is directly at Market Street End. If you go up halfway up Alderley Road, it becomes quite empty. If you turn off down Valencia Road, it is pretty much dead. It may have the side effect of pushing some of the traffic up, but clearly residents will actually park outside their own homes. The people who would push further up will be the people who are going to visit the light at the new cinema development, or who are going to visit any of the shops or eating establishments, which is exactly what we're trying to achieve. Now, I know Matthew is not 100% convinced because he doesn't believe it. What I'm asking for fits these six tests when it comes to actually putting a condition on. So if the committee do not feel fit to add that condition, which has been offered, it's been offered by the developer, who has very kindly joined us here this evening as well. If we don't bite his hand off and put it as a condition because we don't feel it's relevant in planning law, I would suggest that we ask a senior officer to liaise with the developer and see if we can put it as a gentleman's agreement, if you like, and actually bring it forward as a reasonable compromise to actually overcome the issues that I'm talking about. I think the words that Carl used were recommend a commuter sub and use this for monitoring the development of a future scheme, which I think is pretty reasonable, to be fair. Thank you.
Okay, just
one
question. Just a couple of points. You refer to parking policies. you referred to. However, in a sense, they're not just the policies of the planning committee, they are the council's policies. So there will be a route to be able to alter them. I have been coming into the correspondence, so, and I'd like to say from the chair, I'd like to say to the developer, thanks, well done for recognising an issue and for engaging positively with the community and with the ward councillors, and exactly the sort of thing that good developers should be doing. So from the chair, we're obviously looking at a good developer. I don't want to hinder that in any way. One of the problems I think we'll find with the condition is, and I think as Turner will be aware in terms of the policy for residence parking, there are hurdles that will have to be crossed that are out of the control of the developer. So whilst the offer is there and on the table and we're pleased that it's there, the criteria to be met in terms of approval from the local community still has to be taken, because obviously you wouldn't want to force it on a community that didn't particularly want it. Though I'm sure, a lot of communities will say we will want visitors back so if we can perhaps leave that aspect of it there, having noted what I've said from the chair and the developer has said the promise has been made. But as a committee we will place not overly onerous, but we wouldn't place an additional condition or make it any harder than planning already is for developers. But from the chair, just to acknowledge the way that the developers clearly engage with the community and the local council on that. I think we should recognise that when it comes before us. So having said that, open to any of the members for comments.
Just to clarify to Ward Councillor, the children that I made, my colleague next door, it was a Conservative government that brought that policy in. So I'm just highlighting the reason why.
Thank you for that clarity.
What I would say though, if the developer is offering to pay for residence parking, I would definitely take on board all the comments from Carl. For someone who was a member of the Residents Park Review Panel that brought the recommendations to Council, it's going to be really hard to, as you said, it's going to take up to 90% of the community in that area to agree to it in the first place. But given where you are, I think the majority of them will actually accept it. And if the developer's going to pay for it, then that's absolutely fantastic.
I can't remember the dates of SPD 4 and to which government it falls, but nevertheless, hopefully we'll get the dates in due course. Any other comments? Steve?
I think we need to. Okay, this is a location of its own right for three bedrooms. That's getting in context. Three bedrooms. The site itself, the chairs, has been saved rather than demolished. An urban area, it's quite an exciting scene, and I think this has the sustainability of it. As you say, to the owners of, on anyone who wants to build three bedrooms, you've got to provide a residence parking scheme that would be deemed unreasonable by any flexible imagination. I have some frustration about our parking policy. You know, the one in Port Village I'm talking about, where we had 10 apartments with virtually no parking, because it was on the main route, and can't deny that. Parking streets on the main routes, and I think that's part of national policy guidance as well, as opposed to just to our local guidance. So my view is that it's an enhancement to the scheme of a successful urban development. And if climate emergency is to be believed and to be moved, we will be moving, trying to persuade our society to move to a car-less society or less cars. So to always assume that there will be a car or car parking needed with the development will take a major mindset change. And that's where sometimes climate change policies clash with what people want. We've got to lead and say it's not only then in with our climate emergency policies, we will have a scarecrow to it. To use car parking on the three bedroom as a reason for refusal, I think the screen scene issue would have been the issue, but I think it was quite attractive, but beauty is in the eye of the other.
Thanks, Jim. And I'd like to thank the developer for the member offer, certainly for residence parking. I'm sure whether it's conditional or not, that offer will still be on the table. As previous speakers have said, we'll be before the house has, there is quite a value that needs to be reached in terms of agreements and number of residents and proxies involved for the residence parking scheme to be compliable. So, whilst on this, I don't think it would be reasonable to condition this. As a condition on this application, I'm sure that the offer of support will be there regardless of whether it's a condition or not. I'm not going to tie this application down on that condition. Maybe potentially the residents don't want residence parking. We just don't need to be forced on people. So.
I'd like to say it's a very nice development. I think it looks lovely. I follow myself, but what was I doing? I understand Jeremy's concerns for the residents in additional parking, but I don't think there's a correlation between additional bedrooms and people staying. And personally, I turn more toward green wardrobes and perhaps a hesitant to put in the parking sense.
I don't have any pairs of shoes, you've got
Yes, move on back to the application. Steve's quite right. It's a iconic building and it's isolated. I think the application before us because of some building, the way it had to squeeze into the existing structure, it had to, the change was more than just material, and I think Councillor Cox also acknowledged the quality of the. Of the development and the fact that it's been able to keep a landmark building in place. So,
yeah, just like everybody else, really care. I think of as Councillor Wallasey, I think of a number of similar buildings within 5-10 minutes walk from here that have been lying derelict for 10-15 years that have been really nice. So, well, be a similar size and style of development as this. So, I think in terms of design, bringing that sort of building back into use clearly has to be welcomed. It's not the developer's fault, but it's in the location of this, in terms of parking. We have the straight by parking policies, and if he's prepared to put in some money, offers over that, so to speak, to pay for parking scheme, I'm sure Councillor Cox will pursue that with him, regardless of whether it's an issue or not on this application. So, like everybody else, I think it's a fantastic opportunity.
Okay, then I shall progress and move approval.
Second. Do you want a second?
Can see those in favour of approval of it. And those against? Okay, thank you. That application has been approved. This brings us now to order. Okay, so agenda item 3. Is for the installation of 7 fascia signs at the already approved McDonald's site. It has attracted a petition of 219 signatures. Is there a representative of the petitions here? Very clearly, I suspect it was linked more closely to the decision we took at the last committee. So, unless any members have any comments, then I'll move approval.
I'm all getting around handy, but in the interest of, we have a set procedure, we only have a presentation, then we could go to the vote.
The development chairman has indicated he had nothing to add really to the description. To the description, the description of the application rather spoke for itself. It was 7 signs.
That's clear.
I'm sorry, it probably I should have made it clear that I had asked whether he was having a talk. Okay, then let's Agenda item number four, the installation of two freestanding 12 metre high totem signs. Again, the relevant job manager indicates that his presentation is two totem signs. One of which says 1 hour, and the other one says 24 hours. Any additional comments? Okay, then I'll move approval. That's seconded. See those in favour? And those against? That application has been approved. That leads us down to... So that brings us on to agent items of business. As David Ball has circulated for us a report on the establishment of a subcommittee, which every all members have been able to see. The recommendation that the subcommittee comprising 9 members of the planning committee is established to make a consultation regarding the building and school committees and public recommendations to Cabinet in the formulation of the local development framework for the Borough. I propose to say much on that. I think we know that the local plan is in production. We know there's a advisory group comprising the group leaders which are dealing with the strategic matters. We've had some discussion even today about some of our development control policies, parking, houses and multiple occupation, we haven't touched on today. I know George and Stuart and Ian are still concerned about. There is a body of work to be done on detailed policies. That isn't a matter that would sit easily with a leaders group. The expertise is here. I also see, I'm about to say, the subcommittee evolving to start to look at some of the issues that were raised by the LGA recent peer review. One of the stand-up points for me was our taking ownership of our performance and performance of the department. I know that information at the fingertips of planning officers and have circulated some of that detail to me in advance of my meeting the peer reviewers. But that's the sort of thing we probably ought to be looking at, along with land use and the strategic questions. My view from the beginning has been the subcommittee is the best vehicle for other views and there are other potential models. However, it being July in the summer, it would be nice if we could agree this as a way forward. Everything is open to review. It turns out that it doesn't work, it needs to be bigger, or what have you. It can obviously be reviewed, but the work needs to be done. And we need to have a body that looks at some of our strategic policies, our strategic direction. On the department that is separate from our activities as a development control committee. So I will open for debate and from the chair, just for the avoidance of doubt, move the recommendations as the under discussion. Stephen.
Number of points here. First and foremost, when I ask my members if you want to be part of it, we want to know the sort of regularity of meetings and the time and so on, which we have issues with. I don't know what proposal that is to help people make their commitments. Clearly, the expectation is that it is on an evening, not daytime, because any members can work by the commitments. Second point is that clearly we are on a tight deadline for the local plan. My view is that this committee should have in its mindset before it starts out to assist the local plan meeting the deadline rather than create itself a hindrance or a slowing down procedure in any way. I agree, we are over certain areas of policy, HMOs is a good example where we've battered that round and gone on. But that must be done again against the tight deadline of reaching the goal of a 20th November 2020.
November 2020 submission.
Yeah. So hopefully we can all sign up to that. And finally, we're happy to take on board. We just wonder if a decision is made there, where the ultimate decision is made. I presume it's still with cabinet under the current constitutional. So, but I don't particularly think it's going to be a clash. To ensure that continuity, that golden thread, the suggestion has been made from one of my group that we invite Anita Leach as an ex officio member if she wishes to attend any of the sessions. But don't sort of basic sort of understanding that we're happy to move a set of names
we'll just respond to that. And I'll do that for the names. What do you mean? Well, I think we need to establish this and then have a vote on that. As I was saying, a couple of issues that it would be an even meeting. My initial view was that it would follow. Would be on the same day, which is going to be a Tuesday. Follow the leaders' advisory group. And that would potentially make it easier for a meeting. I have no objections at all to cabinet members as ex officio. I appreciate she's not a direct member of this committee nor a deputy. So that would need to be found. In terms of decision making, the constitution is clear about the role of the planning committee. It is to advise the decision making. Decision making will be, in first instance, I understand the cabinet member, but in terms of some of the policies could well be from council. So I suspect a lot of the decisions that come out of the subcommittee will actually be recommendations to another body. I think the first meeting that we have, and I'm undecided in my mind whether that should be next month or September. September may very well be, but I'm happy to enter into discussion with Blasey spokespeople about that and to create that aware programme. At our first meeting in September, I'm sensing in September. We'll probably be more comfortable for officers as well. But in the interim, maybe via email, we can begin to create our agenda and what it is that we feel that we want to do. Does that
more
the answer? So I'm thinking monthly, but it is going to be a work in progress a little as we move through that. Stuart.
Thanks, Chair. Certainly support this proposal. I think it can be finessed over time, and there's always the next hours. That's to know what works best and try and give ourselves more flexibility. But I think, in terms of the plan, but also the improved needs to make some plan steps and our policies, I think we've got a huge job to do, and I think we should need to get on with us. So, I'm happy to.
I fully support the idea. I think it's a really good idea to be honest, and I think having input from experienced planning members into the local plan would be a very useful addition.
Thanks. Just on your question, I'm glad to answer. To be absolutely clear, it is not in anyone's interest to slow down the development. So certainly the strategic part of it. I understand there's a ton of policies that we might want to look at, that you are parking, whilst they would form part of the local plan, are not actually that part of the local plan that's in dispute, with government. So it wouldn't matter whether within or out. But it's certainly, there is a suite of policies that I think we're clear in our own mind as a planning committee are out of date and need to be reviewed. With that said then, can we vote on the recommendation and establish the committee? You see those in favour? And any against?
Stuart, Davies, Stuart, Whittingham and Samantha.
Conservatives will be Geoffrey Walsh, Hunter Garden, and Ian Lewis.
Green, Steve Hayes.
And the Dumbledore will be by itself. And in addition, we will resolve to co-opt Meet Leach on as an ex officio. So the decision that we would make, she would have a vote on this, but the decision that we would make would be sent in after the decision that any